the founder of the woman's company. I mean, I don't think it could get more interesting than this. Something like this, especially in a country like India. How does it, how long has it been since you've started the company, and how has been your journey till now?
So we started the woman's company on the 8th of March, 2020. So right before lockdown, interestingly enough. But I think it's been an interesting ride. We've managed to keep delivering our products, all essential services. So we've managed to, you know, keep them kind of on the road and, you know, been able to kind of get them to women as and when they needed them. So I think that's the main thing that we're quite pleased about.
Yeah. And, you know, you were talking about you wouldn't want your daughter to use the kind of products that exist in the market.
So I've worked in women's healthcare for the last 20 odd years. So I've worked very closely in either building women's brands or working with women themselves for their health and wellness. So it's a great passion of mine. My daughter is hitting puberty, and when I was thinking about the kind of products that I would like her to use, something that would start her period journey positively, something which would help her associate periods with something which is natural and happens every month and is not something to be scared of or something to be depressed about. Then I started thinking about what in this area that I could do, you know, and that was my next kind of venture into healthcare. That's how the women's company was formed, and we do provide intimate hygiene, menstrual hygiene products for women. So we do pads, we do the world's first teenage pad. It's made of super soft cotton. It's tailor-made to be a smaller size for young girls so that they can start their journey positively. They can continue their activities, not worried about the pad bunching up while they're playing soccer or doing karate or whatever else they want to do. So this is how we kind of launched with just this SKU products. And as we go on, there's a whole bunch more that we're planning to do as well.
Oh, I think what you're doing is very much in need of the hour. Anika, from your experience, I want to understand, a lot of women ignore their hygiene, and you've dealt with so many women. What is the reason that you feel that women are not that focused or keen on, you know, their hygiene?
I don't think it's their hygiene particularly. I think women aren't focused on their health. Women don't put their own health as a priority, because they're so busy playing all these multiple roles that they play. So mother, wife, daughter, daughter-in-law, friend. I mean, I have seen women put their own, health, or if they're not feeling well, they'll put off a doctor's appointment. They'll put off a checkup about a niggling, thing that's troubling them. They'll keep putting it off because there's so many different things that they're trying to manage and juggle, that becomes the priority, you know. Rather than this. And in terms of, that's urban society. In terms of rural societies, women aren't given the opportunities to be as educated as everyone else, you know? And so as a result, you know, they don't have as much information. They're also caught up in their daily grind, so they don't have a lot of time. They are, you know, the same kind of nuskas are passed down from generation to generation, and that's what they kind of use to protect themselves. Having said that, a lot of really good organizations, NGOs, are working in this space towards, you know, either building awareness or building products or building services to be able to provide them to women. Now it's just a matter of everyone actually getting to those women and being able to help them, you know. So I'm already seeing a large shift in the last few years as opposed to many years before, where, you know, this kind of change wasn't prevalent.
What do you think will bring about a change? What do you think can be a good, conversation starter amongst urban women when it comes to self-care, self-love, keeping their health as priority?
I think one of the main things that we as women, all of us, should do is, you know, to be able to take that time out for ourselves. So whether it's the right foods, whether it's the right products, whether it's the right, making that appointment, getting your health checks done, So making sure that, you know, you are getting checked for everything once a year. I think it's about having conversations about how we are important as well. And, you know, it's that cliche that if the juggler's okay, the balls can keep juggling. But if the juggler falls, then who's going to keep those balls in the air? You know, so it's a matter of also just keeping that juggler going. So we look at it because women are beaten by guilt, and, you know, we are beaten down by a lot of guilt for all the roles that we play. I think we need to be reminded that if we really want to play those roles well, then we should put ourselves first. We are worth that extra time. We are worth that little bit of extra money if we have it, you know, and also we are worth being invested in by other, as I said, NGOs, organizations, companies that can actually provide products or services or healthcare with care.
Anika, how do you manage your own time? You're a mom, you're balancing all these roles, and you're in a role that's where you have to be empathetic and you have to understand all the roles that women are managing and design products for them.
I mean, I have been working throughout. I've been a single mother now for the last 7.5 years. So that itself, it has its rewards and challenges. It's not easy, and women, whether they are single, whether they are married, whether they have a support system, whether they don't, you know, whether they're working or they're not, I think it's difficult for women because of the way that we beat down on ourselves in terms of this guilt. So I think that's something that I stopped doing a while back. When I'm at work, I'm focused on work. When I'm with the kids, I'm focused on the kids. And I also take out a little bit of time to do stuff for myself. You know, Veda, I lost my parents very young. Lost my dad 14 years ago. I lost my mom 2 years ago. It's been a really rough ride. I also run an NGO called Organ India. I founded it to help people who were having transplants because my mother had a heart transplant a few years back. And I felt that there was a need for families to have a support system in place in terms of information and, you know, connectivity to doctors, hospitals, etc. So we're a fairly large NGO in this space now. We work very closely with the health ministry. So I think one of my secrets is that I've got an amazing team. I've got people who own the concepts as much as I do. They really care about the work that we've mutually co-created. They're far smarter than me, so I'm very smart, where I partner with people who are very, very smart, smarter than I am. I'm always honest with my children, and I do take out time for myself, whether it is, you know, cooking, which I like and I find unwinding, or it's cycling, or it's playing the piano. I take that time out because I think that's what keeps me sane, and then I can be a better juggler, you know?
Mm-hmm. Very interesting. Where did the name The Woman's Company, you know, how did you come across this? And what was the response that you got when you first named your company?
Well, the response has been phenomenal. I mean, we've had a lot of celebrity appreciation. We've had a lot of women write in saying that they're really excited to see this bold, sexy, you know, red, eco-friendly brand as opposed to sort of pastel colors that have always been associated with women's products. Yeah. The Woman's Company came up because, you know, that's what I've done my whole life. I've worked for women, and, you know, I am a woman, and everything in my life is about being an empowered woman and supporting women to become more empowered. So it just made sense. It just came to us, and then it just made sense to go with it. Also, it, you know, The Woman's Company is going to evolve into many different avatars. You know, I mean, there are many possibilities, you know, as to what and many plans that we have. So it becomes this umbrella which, you know, allows for everything and allows for anything, which is why I think we decided to keep it that.
Anika, who inspires you and why?
Every woman inspires me. I mean, I had fantastically strong grandmothers, so I would say that my grandmothers were definitely my role models. One was a doctor, one was a nurse, you know, and they were both pioneers in their own fields, and, you know, outliers in their own family in terms of breaking the mold, very similar to my own life trajectory, because, you know, so much has happened in my personal life. I get a lot of strength from them. I have an incredibly strong mother who did shoulder a lot, and she's a definite source of motivation for me. My daughter is my inspiration. You know, I mean, she's the one who's, you know, the ethos behind the company itself, because I hope it's a better world for her and for your daughter and all our daughters, you know, to come. Every woman has a story, and these stories are what just intrigue me like crazy, you know. So I am generally inspired by all women of all shapes and sizes and ages.
No, it is, I feel it is harder in a country like India to, you know, be a woman. It is definitely a struggle in itself. I want to know, what would be your topmost advice to an aspiring, you know, young entrepreneur or any aspiring woman who wants to dive into the workforce?
I think it would just be dive in. There's a lot out there on women having a hard time in terms of the corporate ladder, in terms of starting a venture. But, you know, I have had a lot of that strife as well along my journey. So I believe that if you have the right intent and you have a drive and you have a strong vision and you have the conviction behind your vision, things just fall into place. So I would say, be yourself, be authentic, and don't take no for an answer, no matter what where you read it, who says it to you, and, you know, how they say it, it doesn't matter.